You're listening to the SWN podcast.
And this is SWN.
Welcome to SWN.
Skull! Skull! Skull!
This is SWN.
And this is the Scottish Wrestling Network.
Where Scottish wrestling lives, I guess. Is that a tagline? I guess. I don't know.
Hello and welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. I'm your host, as always, Billy. And joining me, don't adjust your set, it's Billy. So coming back on the show, episode 121, December 2021 was the last time we had you on the podcast. And here we are. Since then, we've one of us has had life-altering surgery. Life-saving surgery.
Good surgery, I think.
Good
surgery.
Another one has had to witness their partner have surgery to born their child. So it's been a very, very weird time since last time we spoke on this old podcast. And
makes me feel so old. Makes me feel so goddamn old. So 3 years ago. Oh my God.
Yeah, just about. Yeah, that's. And at that point, I think, the pandemic was still fairly in the midst. I think stuff was just coming back by the time we actually spoke. And, oh, God. Yeah, it's been
so if it's 2021, I was probably just starting to gig regularly again, like doing stand-up. I think I'd wrestling come back. So if that's December 2021, I think we were maybe doing, like, closed-doors tapings and stuff. Bloody hell, what a time. Oh my God, has anything happened since? No, that's what's happened.
The only thing that's really happened is I've expanded my wall of crap behind me. I think I had like four pops last time we spoke.
Wall of crap's looking good. What are we talking? I mean, the European title being on there. I can't quite see who that is. Is that Willy Pop figures, Funko Pops you've got in the bottom?
So many. Oh, that's a wee custom ones. It's a Scotty Swift. And,
Mr. God, Scotty Swift, there you go.
My wall of crap is just outstanding with a Turbo Man just for bonus. That was a wonderful birthday present. But anyway, this isn't about me, this is about you. So mainly, we're here to plug the Fringe. Plug your show, Wild Thing, taking place at Beehive Inn at the Grass Market in Edinburgh. For those that are unaware, they go 2:45 PM, August 2nd till the 26th. And pay what you can. So you're speaking to people again. You're speaking. You're on the last time we spoke, you were just kind of getting back out there. Now, it's been 3.5 years. You've been gigging again. You've been able to see people and touch people. How's it been? The last few years.
Well, do you know something? It's one of those things. Like, for people that don't know, as well as being a commentator for ICW, I mean, obviously I'm a job in stand up. People might not know that, and every now and then it's quite funny when, like, an ICW fan will turn up at a stand-up gig and then go, "What the fuck?" they don't know, or they go, "This guy sounds a lot like the guy from ICW," or the other way around. That's quite fun. So, in the last few years, obviously stand-up is my stock and trade. It's my job. When everything shut down with COVID, it was quite scary. So back then, we were just hoping we were going to get back out there in any way, shape, or form. Do you know? I mean, there were some people that left the industry when COVID stopped down, but getting back out there and getting gigging it has been wonderful. It has been my solid focus again now since I left the Breakfast Radio show that I was doing. It's been my solid focus now again for the last couple of years. And I've loved it, man. Being back out, getting to interact with people, getting to do gigs all across the country. I've been back over gigging in North America as well, which has been nice, in Oklahoma, which... Oklahoma has a Scottish only festival. Did you know that?
I only knew that because you were at it.
Yep, it still confuses the hell out of me, to be honest. It still confuses. Basically, it was a guy from Scotland moved to Oklahoma and missed Scotland that much that he started his own festival. What a legend. Always, like, you meet all these Scottish people whose name is like Chad and Zip and all this type of thing, all these guys doing. But getting out and about and getting a gig again has just been, it's just been so much fun. And I missed it. You know, it was one thing, like, when COVID happened, I think we both talked about it back then, it was nice to take a little time to kind of, all right, okay, let's maybe reset a wee bit. But man, I'd really missed it. And it's been great to be out gigging again and having a good time.
It's still weird. I mean, for me, it's unleashed this possibility of doing this podcast, because that's why I did it, because I needed some human interaction. And I've realized quite quickly that this is the best way I can speak to people in general, because if I meet them face to face, it's an awkward mess of 5 minutes of lingering and just like just awkwardness in general. But yeah, you did the Zoom gigs as well, of course, because you did my work, my actual job. Christmas
I did
party.
Your job one. That was hilarious to go. Well, I know Billy, because I think I didn't talk to you, or I went out my way to go, I'm not talking to Billy because I know who Billy is.
Pretty much, yeah. And that was the night. Then I ended up asleep on the bathroom floor because we ended up just kept drinking afterwards.
Do you know those gigs, man? Were a lot of people gave like I can't remember if it was on like what is that fucking the Windows one or
Teams.
I don't know. Teams, I can't remember if it was on Teams or whatever it was, but I actually had a lot of love for those gigs. Like, I mean, they were interaction for me. They were the closest to getting to do, you know, what I love to do. But I had actually a lot of love for those gigs. Like, really, and I didn't get as pissed as the audience did. But at least I didn't, you know, I didn't end up with an audience member wrapped around me at the end of the night, you know, stopping me from getting home. So it was nice.
You go. That's always the best way. But yeah, My this is where my everything office is technically, but the bathroom's literally like 10 steps away, well 20 on that night, and yeah, that's where I lived, because it sent us beer, and it was all manner of chaos and that, but you know, good fun anyway.
You know, on stage and performing, I've always said I've always felt it's kind of like my safe space, because like I think in the real world, I'm like I can come across as a little bit of an my wife calls it, I'm an introvert with a gear change, and it's like, what do you mean by that? It's like you have the ability to suddenly become an extrovert when you want to, and people don't see it coming. But essentially, I am happy to be left the fuck alone. You know what I mean? I am happy not when I'm just cutting about the place. I am happy not to be the center of attention. I am happy to just be chilled out. But she calls it the gear change. When the gear change happens, it's like, holy fuck! So when we did that was great for me, because I'm in my happy space here. I'm in my like my little well, I don't have a happy space. It sweats like balls in here in the middle of June, July, I should say. But but still. Yeah, it was great. That was a great night as well. Thank you very much. I do remember that gig. It was a fun.
But yeah, that's it. But finding safe spaces and yeah, yourself getting back out there and actually seeing people. But let's talk about the wrestling a little bit. We'll come back and forth and plug cool, Wild man. Thing as we go.
Cool.
If I remember. But yeah, so I came back, closed door shows. You were kind of were you doing commentary just from where you are now, from your?
Well, we had to find loads of different ways of doing it, man. Like so. Wrestling companies around the world, it was a little different in North America. Like the guy, I've got to say, like, I mean, Mark Dallas at the time, I mean, obviously Dallas has moved on to other things now. He's just, I think, just recorded a thing with Channel 4 just a couple of weeks ago. I don't know if anyone's seen that. Him and a good friend of mine called Stephen Buchanan. But they had to kind of, him and Thomas Cairns and Scott Reed and all these guys, and they ought to sit down and kind of figure out how the bloody hell are we going to do it? Because we wanted to produce like a show that we could still put out on what would have been the WWE Network at the time and still reach out to fans. And the thing is, nobody really knew how to do it. So those guys were trying to figure out how to do the live show. And then me, and it was Jamie Kennedy at the time, we were trying to figure out how we were going to do it. I mean, I was doing radio at the time and doing some other bits and bobs. I was doing like a weekly improv show that we were streaming online. But me and Jamie were having to figure out, how the fuck do we record? Like, this was before Zoom had even really become like a proper tool, if you know what I mean. So we had to try and figure that out. So me and Jamie at one point were kind of in an unofficial bubble, if that makes any sense. We were recording, because I have a theatre company, or mini production company, and we had a space over in Saltcoats. So me and Jamie would meet up there and do social distance commentary. Right. So we're watching the ICW show on this big screen with our headsets on, but being like 2 feet apart from each other, and still doing like tests and all this type of thing, and getting vaccinated, because we're just trying to figure anything out. And then we started doing it online, and then then it got to the point of going, right, well, we can have you guys call in the commentary in another room, because we thought it would be weird guys trying to wrestle without a crowd, but us still sitting in the corner doing commentary would have been quite weird, because all the guys and girls would have heard is me and Jamie talking.
Mm-hmm.
Do you know what I mean? That's yeah. all they would have heard, and it would have been weird for them, and it would have been weird for us. So then very quickly from us getting to interact with the guys again, it was like, oh shit, we can have fans. We're going to have fans. And that was so fucking weird to do commentary, because I'd been quite lucky, because I think by this point I had started doing gigs with audience and live attendance again, like even when it was like social distancing. But the cool thing was is the feedback that I could give the wrestlers, and they were like, and my feedback was, people are dying to get to interact again. People are just, they cannot wait to be at shows, and they can be, you know, like when I was going back to doing gigs in front of live audiences, man, they were so much fun. They were actually giving us a fun. Like, sometimes you thought they were taking the piss. It's like, that joke's not that funny. That joke's just all right. But they were dying to go back. And yeah, so it took us a while to do that. But the closed door things were, it was exciting, man. It was exciting at the time, particularly when we were on the network at the time and people were getting to watch us around the world. So it was cool.
That's it. I mean, you must have got quite a lot of comments from people that not outside of Scotland, because this has been their first kind of Billy Kirkwood experience if they hadn't followed ICW before, because it was on the network, which you now get to put lovingly on your posters, former WWE and all that kind of stuff. Yeah, which you know,
I have to
need.
Say for the record, the posters got done the last couple of years by my kind of agents. And I have constantly went, will you fucking take the WWE logo off it? Please. Although I am on there a couple of times, but it's not going to be a bloody network come January. So you're bloody right, I'm going to spunk that out as long as I can. Because every now and then, if they show an old clip of a Scottish wrestler, there is a chance that my voice might be on it if they use any ICW footage. So I'm taking it, man. I'm taking it. As seen on the WWE network, or heard, I should say.
I mean, I rinsed that during the Thunderdome. I was like, oh, there I am. There you go. Officially on the WWE Network. Circle that. Screenshot.
Take it. Why not?
But yeah, it was a weird time. A weird time in general. But even I know for myself, the first show I got to go back to when it was the crowds came back, it was emotional. I didn't realise how emotional it was going to be until I got to see... I went up to the Northern Hotel WrestleZone. It was my first show back. There you go, ding ding, WrestleZone mentioned in the podcast. It was just, you couldn't believe it. You got just like, I couldn't believe that I felt so emotional about wrestling. I mean, for yourself, that's this kind of, you're so immersed in the commentary side of things and having such a crowd. Yeah, it must be a wee tear in the eye when you're coming out, seeing the ring for the first time again, going, oh God, I actually missed this.
Do you know, it was so cool. It was like, the first time I did, I got to do stand-up in front of a crowd again. So I was maybe a little lucky that I didn't burst out crying when I went and opened an ICW show. But in saying that, the first time I did stand-up was actually... Do you remember when everything was in different levels?
Mm-hmm.
You remember that bit? So I did a gig, I want to say in Bankery, which was like at least 6 weeks before I did like a gig in Edinburgh. Or, you know, it was... ahead, like it was staggered when they were starting to kind of slacking everything off. I did a gig in Bankery, and I've still got the footage of that, because it was like it was one of the first stand-up gigs in Scotland to take place post-COVID. And so I get introduced, please welcome back to stage, first gig we've had in 18 months, Billy Kirkwood. As a walk-up, it is funny because I can see the moment where I nearly cried.
Right.
I can see the moment where I nearly, like, it literally just, it hit me right in the chest, because, man, I thought it'd be naive of us all to go, we're just going to go back. But, you know, the thought occurred, what if this never happens again? You know, what if that was that? So certainly the first time I got to see a wrestling ring again, and I got to see fans again, and I got to see people that, you know, from ICW and all that type of thing, that really hit me, man. I was so happy for everyone. Knowing what everyone goes through as well, like knowing the guys and the girls, and knowing how hard they'd fucking worked, you know, and the guys in ICW and all the sacrifices, man, just to see it again, it's hard not to get emotional for it. So I think wrestling fans, We all watched the Thunderdome. We all watched the closed doors matches, and with all the greatest will in the world, nah, it's just not the same. Everyone remembers Drew winning the title, and as much as a great moment it was, still breaks my heart to this day. Still breaks my heart to this day.
My only solace in it is I never paid for the network for that whole period because I kept getting into the Thunderdome for pay-per-views, and I was like, yes, I'll just be saving my $9.99. Thank you, WWE.
Oh, really? Is that how it works?
Yeah, it was free. Thunderdome was free. So I got in every... I just somehow was able to get in every time. I think I didn't miss a pay-per-view for that 18 months at all. I got to see all of them.
I would just have been so distracted. I think they would have kicked me out, man. Like, it would have just been me sitting there going, blah, blah, blah. Like, although I did watch WrestleMania. I did watch WrestleMania that year in the weirdest way. So I had it here. So I had WrestleMania on the TV, but I had an iPad here and here with two mates on it. So we were kind of talking at the same time and watching the wrestling. So it's the closest we could think of is, like, you know, to kind of enjoy it.
But the other thing, you mentioned that the just like just being distracted off it. I did get chucked out of it twice. And it was ridiculous because I didn't think they listened. They said beforehand, oh, well, we'll tape your reactions and all that kind of stuff. But I got kicked out twice, and it was for booing Sasha Banks when she was a face. And second one was when Drew lost to Randy Orton for the title. And I went, fucking hell. And I was out. It didn't even like delay. I was out. I didn't realize that. I was just like, all right, I'll try and get back in. And that wasn't allowed back in. Thankfully, it was the main event and the show had finished. But like, yeah.
That's bullshit. I couldn't believe it.
I was amazed. I thought, oh, Jesus Christ, they are listening to what we're actually seeing here. And anyway.
I think Triple H should let you get away with that now. Do you know that? I think Triple H should let you get away with that. There we go.
Probably will. I hope we'd never have to see the Thunderdome again, in fairness.
But it would also be that. That would be pretty cool, man, because I won't lie, I found it hard going, to be honest. I found it really, really hard going. But, you know, again, hats off to everyone that made that work, man. Hats off to absolutely everyone. Just shows you the premier talents they are, man, honestly.
But let's move forward then. So Network, we'll move to Triller eventually, but we'll come back to that in a little bit because I want to speak about Great Glasgow Bash, which is, we're jumping a lot of steps here, but the Great Glasgow Bash, which was part of the Glasgow Comedy Festival.
It was, yeah. So I have for a long time had the I have wanted to, how do I put this without making it sound like a fanny? So I have for a long time wanted to do, imagine if you would, and I think the way I've described it is, imagine you found a videotape of a British wrestling company from somewhere around about 1993 or something. Like, it's just like an alternative kind of universe for it. We get to use wrestling stars. It'd be fun. It'd be silly. It'd be over-the-top characters. Still be maybe an over-18s product. But that was kind of, I'd wanted to do something like this for a long, long time. Like, I even have a pad around here filled with characters and ideas. And I went to ICW because, I mean, I could have done it on my own. I don't know anything about running a wrestling show. We want to make that clear straight off the gate. Why I've got, like, you know, I've got a legacy in entertainment. I don't know anything about running a wrestling show. And I thought this might be a good idea. So I went in and I talked to the guys at ICW. And I went, I've had this idea. And the thing is, I bored it, like... Scott Reed said this. He went, we've all heard the version of this idea over the last 10 years because I have bored people with this idea again and again and again and again. Like from, oh, fucking hell, from the Disco Viking to, what was some of the other characters? God, I can't even think. The Dandies. I wanted a tag team called the Dandies that came on with big flowery wigs. What were some of the other ones? The Travel Agent. Gives you a one-way ticket to Penn! There was so many. I can't remember some of my favorites now. Two of them made it in, the accountants. So I went in and I went, I think this would be fun. I'm involved with the Glasgow Comedy Festival every year. The why don't we try and collaborate with them? You know, they'll give a little bit of attention to us. We can have a bit of fun with this. And that's what it was all about. The phrase I kept using was fun, 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 right? And that's really what, you know, Big Duncan, Scott and Thomas and Jester, they all kind of grabbed a hold of and went to be fun. And so that's what we did with the Great Glasgow Bash. But I wanted to do it in collaboration with ICW. So rather than do something completely independent of my own, because I knew I was also going to be busy myself with stuff, it's like, well, let's sit down and talk about it. Originally, we wanted to have like comedians a lot more involved. You know, we were going to have like, you know, talking heads and all that type of thing. But comedians are worse than wrestlers and are the most scatty motherfuckers in the world. They were just a fucking nightmare to deal with. So instead, we thought, wouldn't it be great to come up with our own really fun show, have the tag team tournament in it, have some matches. So ended up in such a fun and ridiculous way. Alternative Universe doesn't even cover it. And we had Jack Jester's character from The Scots, which is a hit BBC One show. We literally pulled him off the screen and he was wrestling. We had Gary Falls, a pretty famous Scottish comedian now, wrestling as Grado's second on the show against Theodoros. They had quite a good match that night. We had The Accountants, who are my favourite tag team I think we ever had, who were... two really skinny guys in suits getting the absolute piss beaten out of them by Arcade Violence, who, it was funny because the idea I'd had with Arcade Violence was to make as most 90s and neon as you could. They'd already kind of embraced a good bit of that. The guys, Brody and Jake Lawless, first time I saw them as a tag team, I was like, I fucking love this. It's like the Brain Busters, if you like, chuck them into the middle of that, you know, Ryan Gosling movie, Driver. Just like, I love this. And they got to have like, I mean, again, it's like, what about shoulder pads? Shoulder pads and neon and face paint and just, those guys got it like straight out the gate. And Scott and Jester and all these guys, they came up with the most amazing ideas. And it ended up just being a really fun show at the Glasgow Comedy Festival, which comedy fans turned up at, wrestling fans turned up at, and is probably one of the... we've had a killer 18 months in ICW. I think we're hitting this really creative kind of like bubble that is just, you know, it's just amazing. But that's one of the most well-received shows we've ever done. I just like, the fans just got it because it just... oozed fun from the opening bell. Do you know what I mean? It was great, absolutely brilliant. I loved being involved and the guys have hopefully taken that on. That universe, that little mini universe that we kind of created, that videotape. I think we're going to be seeing more of that. I think we're going to be seeing more of that. I don't want to give anything away, but Halloween's been mentioned.
Ooh.
Halloween's been mentioned. So fingers crossed. Fingers crossed.
But it had ramifications for the rest of wrestling because, of course, Grado's. Big family wrestling bash as well. That's where we've got to see KOE and their transformation into the
Backstreet kids. Bully Boys.
That's it, Backstreet Bully Boys. They saw that, and of course, Arcade Violence have moved forward. They regained their winning ways by embracing the Night Warriors mentality as well. So the fact that that show has actually had more shake in the foundations of ICW a bit more than possibly anticipated. That must be pretty cool to see your idea finally happen and it's actually
God, I'm not going to take credit for any of those things, but one thing I do like to take credit of is kind of the same sounds, it feels like I'm doing a plug for my stand-up, but I'm really not, but is bringing that element of fun, because Billy, that's what we like about wrestling. If wrestling were dull and a slog, we tune out. But one of the things I think is always we forget about sometimes is the fun element of it. And I think that if you see talents kind of embracing the fun and creative side of things, it really lends to it. So Grado's big family bash thing that he has at the Pavilion is more for families. I get that, but people get to be a little silly. And you know, some of the stuff that I grew up loving about, I used to fucking love Repo Man. Like I loved Repo Man. Repo Man gets no respect. I loved Repo Man. And those type of gimmicks and what have you, but people might eye roll too. But now there's a whole generation of people that go like, I miss those gimmicks. Where are those fun gimmicks? Or people that have never seen wrestling, you know, and they might watch, I don't know, okay, they watch Okada versus Orange Cassidy. And it might be a great match, but if you don't know a little bit about Okada's gimmick that he's doing now in AEW and a little bit more about Orange Cassidy, you might miss it. Might miss the kind of, you know, the fun element to this. So that's why I'm a big believer in we need fun in wrestling. As much as it's light and dark. The serious storylines, the dark storylines of those characters when we are being serious and hard-hitting, they need the other stuff next to it. So sometimes, man, sometimes you don't want to drink water. You want to have a fucking Capri Sun. Do you know what I mean? Just break it up a wee bit in a night out. You want a wee shot of Sambuca. Do you know what I mean? In a night out, in between the beers. I know it's not recommended, but there we go. That's what we want.
But you're absolutely right. I think since all bad things of the pandemic and all that kind of stuff happened, I realized that I like story. Give me story. I'm not interested. I mean, I'll watch it. I may enjoy some of it, but I don't enjoy like, oh, it's two wrestlers. One's going to be a good wrestler. One's going to be a better wrestler than the other. No, no. Give me something stupid. Give me something just like, oh, this guy is, you mentioned the Repo Man. A guy that I really started to love, thanks to OSW Review, was the Mountie.
And Mountie!
I watched it going, this isn't your five-star whatever classic, but I'm watching a Mountie beat up a prison guard and vice versa, and I am bloody loving it. And if for the show, I'll take it.
I like entertaining. I mean, look at Matt Cardona, what he's doing in GCW. How bloody, look at Joe Hendry. How entertaining are all these guys? If we care about the person, right? If we care about who they are and what they do, we're going to care about the match. But, you know, we want to be booing and cheering. We want to be along for the ride. As much as it is nice to get those big match feels, I mean, you think, like, if Cody versus Roman Reigns had nothing else behind it, it would have been a good match, but it would have been a 40-minute match. Mm-hmm. Do you know what I mean? And you would have been like, fucking Jesus, boys, let's get on with this. But because of everything that was behind it, how much were you losing your mind? What a match. And in terms of the stuff that guys are doing, it's great to see people being creative and getting out of the bubble, because I think somewhere along the lines, people forgot that that's what we like in wrestling. We like characters. We like to be colourful and entertaining, and wrestlers cannot feel... It's the missing link in wrestling. I think too many people can get lost in, hey, if you turn up in a gimmick and you commit to that, man, you could be the worst wrestler in the world. You'll get a reaction. But if you're a good wrestler and you're entertaining, fucking hell, the sky is the limit for you. The sky is the absolute limit. And I think the way wrestling is now, even in terms of the big companies and who they're signing, I think that's all in display, man. Mm-hmm. Look at Toni Storm. Look at how amazing is Toni Storm. She is the highlight of AEW for me. Like, honest to God. And look how much WWE fumbled her. Jesus, if she went back there now, she would be a superstar. A superstar.
It's absolutely. I mean, you mentioned Joe Hendry then. So we'll talk about Joe Hendry. And I've said his name plenty of times, but thankfully, he's too busy to appear.
I think we've got to do the hand clap.
All right.
I think we'll be... We're not doing it. He's busy. He's going to be annoyed if he gets pulled all the way to Inverness and Ayrshire at the one time. He's going to be annoyed.
He is. But you've seen Joe Hendry pretty much from the start. Just about the start. I think he had a couple matches in SWA and then turned up in ICW. Yes. So to see him from that point, and he'd always seem to be kind of not the complete character, but you could see him and go, oh, you don't need much to get to where you need to, where you want to be. So to see him from that point, and now to see him appear on NXT, this just yesterday as we're recording, in the main event, pinning the main event, winning the match for his team as well, pinning Sean Spears, that's just mental.
do you know, I can still remember the first time I met Joe Hendry, and what... Random things like I remember how big he was, because he was noticeably bigger than a lot of other people as well. But Joe had it from kind of like day one. He had an intangible sort of quality to him. And I'm not saying like, oh, you know, I know a superstar when I saw one, but he got it. He knew he kind of how he composed himself. And you knew this was somebody that's going to put in the work, you know, there before anyone. First one to turn up, last one to leave. And to see how bloody talented he was from day one is unbelievably exciting. And to see his hard work pay off, I think, is the coolest thing about it. Like, I'm sure there's plenty of people out there that would take credit for Joe, and Joe did the right thing when he was growing up. He sought out mentors, he sought out people to talk to, he learnt, he worked harder than anyone else. When something wasn't working, he'd find a way to go out and make it work. I mean, everyone, like, and he's had good and bad times. You know, he's had times where he felt like he was on the, you know, he maybe wasn't where he wanted to be in pro wrestling. Like, people forget he had an original run TNA, and then he was in ROH, and then he grew there, and then he found himself back to TNA, and now there he is, like you say, headlining, main eventing one of the biggest wrestling shows on the planet, and the place losing its mind. It is amazing to see, and I've been relatively quiet on the whole thing, but you know something, I actually, his reaction when he came out last night, the reaction the crowd gave him, and even just to look at him and just like, just so good, it's buzzing. How good for you, man. You've earned every fucking second, and I don't think there is anybody in the industry here in the UK or anywhere that can have a negative experience of Joe Hendry, in my mind. And, you know, man, it's not easy in any creative industries, and I consider wrestling to be a creative industry. Like, you will get people that will try and keep you down. You will get people that are trying to badmouth you, backstab, all that type of petty playground bullshit. But that was Teflon to Joe Hendry. He just kept going in the direction he wanted to do. And now he's in one of the main events. I mean, he's not going to give a shit what I think, but I could not be prouder. Because I remember us doing commentary on wrestling shows together, and I always enjoyed our time together as well, when we were traveling up and down the road to ICW shows. I found him to be a fucking funny guy as well. I think that's pretty evident from the songs and stuff that he did. but funny, intelligent, grounded, just an absolute sweetheart of a guy, and I'm so fucking delighted for him. And this is the thing, like, everyone's going to turn around and go like, I'm sure they, oh, you know, shit, it's just the song and all this type of thing. Not even, you haven't even touched what he's capable of yet. Where Joe Hendry's going to go from this point in, like, where we are right now, I believe in Joe Hendry and the double clap, right? It's just one of the things he's going to do. He's always going to recreate, always going to reinvent himself. I think Joe is the potential of being a world champion in any major company he decides to make his permanent home. And that's it, really.
He's a guy that, well, to the fact that he's so, like, not dangerously talented, but the fact that he was supposed to be one of the subjects of one of the Fight Club documentaries, and they were going to throw a wrestler into some Commonwealth wrestling, and it wasn't really fun for the BBC because he just went in and smashed everyone and actually won. And then he went off to the Commonwealth Games. He's like, the BBC couldn't find an angle for that was supposed to be funny or see a struggle, because he just went in and just did it.
This was a guy that was already excelling in music and then went, I'm going to do wrestling. And in the middle of the wrestling journey, went to the Commonwealth a legit Commonwealth Games. And really, he should have advanced on that. I mean, he got kind of, I'm a bit of a nerd when it comes to freestyle wrestling and what have you. Joe should have done a lot better in the Commonwealth Games. Got kind of fucked over with that. So I just want to, you know, anyone out there, he's legit. Like, this big fucking handsome bastard is legit. It must be funny that now, whoever the makers were of, you know, the shows back then, must be sick. Must be sick. Like, here's this bona fide superstar now, who is now a viral sensation, who has more eyes on him than probably anything you've ever made. I think Joe's played the long game on that one, to be honest. And you know, the thing is, man, I think he's so bona fide talented. I think he's the type of guy that could end up being like an actor or a TV presenter or a pundit, whatever else he wants to do along with what he does. It makes me sick.
I know. And then you get the like, says his age or something like that, and you go,
oh man,
like, looking just, sharp being the prime example of going, screw you, how dare you.
I just honestly so excited for him. Like, I really genuinely am. As a wrestling fan, it's great to see someone you've got a lot of respect for doing well, but when someone is just doing it in such a way that no one else has done. And that was the thing. I was watching his entrance last night, and I've seen the Joe Hendry entrance 100 times now, you know what I mean? But I was watching it last night and going, nobody's doing this. Nobody is doing this and getting that reaction. I know, like, Seth Rollins will get, you know, the reaction to his entrance, and then, you know, CM Punk is CM Punk, and, you know, I think of all those things, but And then all those guys can deliver in the ring. You know, I want to make that clear. Joe can has been able to deliver in the ring for a long time as well. But just seeing all the intangible elements, it comes back to what we were saying about the Great Glasgow Bash. People care about Joe Hendry. People, they are on board. It's part of a movement. And to just see it, man, it goes like, fuck. And it, and the fact it's so clever, like the song literally tells you what to do.
Yeah.
Like the whole song tells you what to do, from waving your hands to believing in Joe. He's got his fucking name in the song. How clever is that? That his name is in the song. He owns it. He owns it, man. No, we're going to repackage you. We're going to call you Scots McKilt. Now you know, because I'm Joe Hendry. And everyone's just going to sing that I'm Joe Hendry. Remember that weird bit in WWE NXT UK where they tried to rename Sha Samuels?
Oh, was it something Hardy?
Ed Hardy.
That's the one.
But what? What? I mean, I was not involved in it. I mean, I was never involved. Hey, listen, if they want to call, I'm happy to be involved. Oh, someone's pinging me. Shut the fuck up. Well, it might be you, actually. Never involved with the creative side, but I can tell you this right now. That's not a decision I would have made.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and I think as well, like, Joe's had the opportunity. And I don't want to speak ill. I mean, Joe, I'm sure, has his own, but I'm sure I've heard him speak about this. He's had the opportunity to work, do X, Y, and Z when he was climbing up the ladder. But to make all those decisions and bet on yourself, sorry, MJF, but to just bet on yourself and it to end up like this is just amazing. It's just amazing. Joe could be on Monday Night Raw and get the same reaction. Mm-hmm. You know, Joe could be on SmackDown and get the same reaction. Joe could be in the commentary desk of any major wrestling company and excel at it. I mean, CM Punk talks about all the things he's good at. Well, here's Joe Hendry. How many songs have you written, CM Punk? Just making that, you know, just chucking it out there. He's got a couple of albums worth, which I have ruined several times as well, which I would like to apologize.
I mean, I still love Angeline, which was his first entrance theme, but, you know, that's just because I'm old school. Yeah. I'm old school, a bit lost in audio. But you speak about that, is about Joe Hendry's kind of rise and betting on himself. We're seeing in WWE now, especially WWE, that there's no one way for a Scot to make it in WWE, because Drew came from the indies, he made it to WWE off his own back kind of thing, and then he returned because of such a buzz that he created during his time away. Then you got the Gallus guys, they came through NXT UK. You got Alba Fire, or Kaylee Ray, and Isla Dawn as well, who came through NXT UK as well. It's just we're very blessed in this tiny country to have so many talented people that have appeared on these global stages. I mean, you'll never accept this compliment, but even for yourself, hearing a Scottish voice on the WWE network was just thrilling as a fan, someone who's watched wrestling for 25 years-ish, to be able to hear a Scottish voice on wrestling on a global scale is just, it's incredible. It just makes you want to go, right, I can do this. I want to try something so I can make it there, because if it's possible kind of thing. And it must be, yeah, humbling to see these people, and also humbling to receive these compliments as well from everyone that's out with the UK that have heard your voice and how it's added to shows that they're watching, whether it's through the network or through Triller as well. Must be humbling.
It's very kind of you to say that, and I appreciate that. Anyone that has ever taken time out to even reach out and say anything nice to me personally, I appreciate it. Thankfully, it's not as much. If a commentator does their job right, you kind of don't notice we're there. So that's kind of that in its way is a compliment. You know what I mean? We're just there. I'm sure first time my voice was heard on the WWE network, the rest of the planet was confused. But that's neither here nor there. It is amazing to see our talents. And I've said for a long time, I still feel like there are talents here and there's stuff we're producing that needs to be seen further afield, that still needs to be seen further. But it is amazing to see the guys that have made the journey through Scottish wrestling, ICW and beyond, on the WWE network. And they're all people that deserve to be there. You know, I mean, we can't forget Noam Dar. We can't forget Piper Niven as well, who... I still don't think they've... I mean, I'll come in and say that. I still don't think they've even, you know, pinged open the ripcord on what Kim is capable of.
Nikki. as well.
And Nikki, of course. Oh my God. I mean, again, there's another. You think about Nikki's run, right? I mean, I like people underappreciate Nikki Cross. I'm going to come out and say, I think, and they don't when she's there and she's present. They go, this is amazing because she's so good at what she does. But you think about the run she had in Sanity, which was fantastic. You think about the run she had as the... I can never remember.
Almost a Superhero.
Almost a Superhero. And make it just... There's an example of someone else that just makes it work. Everything they gave her, she makes it work. And I think she's got a fucking like doctorate now or something. Like I think she's got like a PhD. She definitely went and got a university degree while doing all this. As well as getting married and all this, you know, type of stuff as well. Nikki is an underappreciated one. And what she's doing right now with the Wyatt Six, I'm very excited for. It ticks so many boxes with me. Like, being an old goth myself and everything that's going on with the Wyatt Six is doing fantastic. But regardless, but you're right to bring her up. There's so many talents, and it's great to see those guys getting the platform, the work they put in, and being able to relearn how to, and I think that says a lot to them, and it says a lot to, you know, like Joe Hendry's even as well. Going to the WWE, you almost have to relearn. You have to show that you're talented, but you also have to learn to work their style and excel at that. And even though I don't think it's quite, that means quite once, it maybe once did under certain regimes, you work the WWE style, they seem to strip everything away, but where they are now, they really want to bring what makes you unique and emphasize it. And I think the fact that the coffees, obviously, I mean, I've known Joe, feels like a long time now. And I always knew that Joe would be a main eventer in WWE. And I think the fact he hasn't had that title around his waist yet pisses me off, but that's neither here nor there. And of course, Big Wolfgang and Mark Coffey. Gallus is a fantastic unit who, again, I think could be at home anywhere on the roster, you know? It's just great to see them do that. And I think you're right. It does kind of send a signal to our locker room, to other locker rooms across the UK, that it is not as far away as you think, and that you are going to have to bet on yourself. And yet, one week you might be doing a scout hall in Wolverhampton, and the next day you might be doing the Hammersmith Ballroom or the Hammerstein Ballroom in New York, you know, and you might not be earning a lot of money for it, but you're making the miles and it's all going in the right journey. You know, you're on the journey to do it. And that's what these guys all had to go through. Do you know what I mean? Like, I'm sure if we could get on any of our Scottish roster members, I'm sure if we could get them on this show and go, give me five of your worst wrestling experiences, we'd all be horrified. But maybe that's from, you know, stand-up, because I've done some gigs that were fucking atrocious, but I've had a great time doing them. And I've used them to learn. That's what these guys did. And I think I would hope it's the message that people learn. It doesn't come easy, but, you know, the rewards can be incredible. And it makes me smile every time I see our guys getting a spot and getting spotlighted. And you think of Joe and Drew right now. Drew, who might be hands down the best heel on the planet right now. Yep. I think might be the best heel on the planet. And I know people are going to say, oh, what about MGF and all that type of thing? I mean, just consistency. It's two different leagues. Mm-hmm. I think, I'm not saying that because Drew's a mate and I've worked with Drew. I'm saying that just because as a wrestling fan, it's unbeatable. It's unbeatable what he's doing, and he's constantly on, man. I just think it's brilliant. It's wonderful to see.
Well, speaking of Drew, I was going to go back into the Fringe show, but you mentioned Drew. I think it's best that we talk about After Hours for a moment. My fun fact about Drew is every time I see him, I jokingly turn to my wife and go, I was security for him once in Inverness, and I'm fairly certain if anyone came at me, I was not going to stop them. I'd started to stand there. It's a poster. You can't see it because it's above out of camera line. But Rock and Wrestle up in Inverness, and I was his security while he was signing posters and looking at him going, if anyone comes to you, Drew, I will not be able to stop them. You're going to have to do this. But yeah, anyway.
You know, Drew has always been really nice to me. And when I was on Radio in Ayrshire, I thought it was quite funny that he had friends who considered me to be a celebrity in comparison to him. which made me laugh and go like, oh, you know Billy off West End. it's like, yeah, but I'm over like doing Madison Square Garden. Aye, but you know, he's on the radio in the morning. It's like that really made me laugh. That's, but then the comparison away, it's like, you know, that's the same thing happens to me now. It's like, fuck. But Drew's always been really nice. I do remember he tried, bless him, he didn't need to, he tried to get me the gig with Five Star. Well, he got me the gig with Five Star Wrestling, because this is the, I've never really talked about this much, Billy. I don't know if you knew this, but I was meant to be the lead commentator for Five Star Wrestling.
I want to know everything about Five Star Wrestling.
Right, well, I can't tell too much because it's a while ago now, so I'll surmise it. So Five Star Wrestling was getting up and running, and Drew, bless him, threw my name in the hat to be the lead commentator. I even went to meet the guys from Channel 5. That's how far we got. And I had the meeting and all this type of thing. But I did sense that things weren't quite right. I can say that. And people go like, ah, bullshit. Well, here it is. There are people that can back me up. I had just started, literally just started a breakfast radio show. Like, I had just started. And I think I was doing Warm Up and Robot Wars at Christmas. And the way they were talking, I could not see how I could sustain doing all those things, let alone one of those things. I'd be different now. I'd probably say yes. But I made the decision of not to do it. It was just a case of, I don't see how I could do it. But they wouldn't give me dates. They wouldn't give me money or anything like that. So I ended up just hosting the press conference to launch it. And then away I went. But bullet dodged. But it would have been nice experience. It would have been nice experience. Instead, I pumped it off on Greg Lambert, who did a great job. But yeah, that was meant to be. I smelt a rat. Smelt things weren't quite as they should have been, and politely declined. So if the guys are watching now, that is the honest truth. I was too busy and I did not feel it was the right decision to make. So there we go. But a big thanks for Drew for putting me forward for it, because I would have loved to work with him closely. Don't know how many shows he did though. Don't think he did that many either, I come to think of it.
I don't think he did. He didn't do the shows on Channel 5. He did the Dominant Wrestling, which was a terrible name. But he did the Dundee one. I think that was it.
Yeah, because it was like a pilot in Dundee.
Aye. Yeah,
that was the one that they originally wanted me for. And then go, oh, and then we'll do all the other dates and all this type of thing. And I think even then I was asking, this is all boring self-employed stuff, but it was like, so how much am I getting paid? And is my travel going to be taken care of? And am I getting hotels and all that? You know, just the questions that you ask. Because like, you know, you don't want to be going, oh yeah, we're going to pay you 250 quid, but you're going to spend 280 getting to the tape. You know, you just started, you know, I've got kids and stuff, so I've got bills to pay. But we didn't get that far. I politely declined. And then the night they were actually taping that Dundee one, I was actually doing a gig in Aberdeen on the night. But I don't think Drew did that one. But then I also did the calculations of like, how are they going to make money when they're bringing in Bobby Lashley, Rey Mysterio, who else?
Jack Swagger, of course.
Jack Swagger. Fuck yeah. Jack Swagger. John Morrison.
John Morrison, yeah.
You start doing all the at one point I was meant to be doing commentary with Kurt Angle.
Right.
I was meant to be doing commentary with Kurt Angle. That did come up. And I was like, shit. I mean, but what it was worth, I got the blessing from ICW to do the Dundee show. I did get the blessing. I asked Dallas, like, am I okay to do this? I mean, I'm not gonna, you know, just out of courtesy. Because ICW has been my home in pro wrestling. You know, it's like, even though I've never felt at any point that I wouldn't be allowed, but I think you ask. It's polite. And if they turned around and went, we'd rather you didn't, it's like, that's cool. Then we know where the cards are on the table. We've got a legacy and we're all good. But I did get a blessing, but no, it didn't happen. And then I watched from afar how things went. And I kind of wish it hadn't, but it seemed quite unpleasant.
Yeah, I mean, I for what they were, I enjoyed it, but haven't really seen it in a submission match. Anyway, yeah, I kind of.
So what I'm saying is, Drew, if you're listening, you owe me one.
You've no affiliation, but send a word to WOS Wrestling. We'll see.
To what? Sorry.
WOS Wrestling, World of Sport. It's coming back.
Hey, listen, I would love to work for World of Sport. It's one of the things, like, one of the big problems with my career is I don't really know how to, like, open doors in places. Like, people go, oh, why don't you send them an email? It's like, saying what? Saying what? What do you do? If they're not interested, they're not interested. Do you know, again, there's another thing. What if? I only found this out recently. But when What Culture Pro Wrestling started up, apparently my name was in the frame to join them as a commentator. This is what I can say to the good people at What Culture Pro Wrestling. You've never got in touch. You've never asked. Why would I hassle you? Apparently that's what you're meant to do in wrestling. You're meant to, like, pure hassle people and blah, 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 and all that. Maybe that's the problem. They're probably right and I'm wrong. Mm-hmm. But you never asked. They never asked. I wouldn't have known what to do. Would I email, hey, I would love to do commentary for you. And they'd be like, fuck off, needy. You know,
that's how I feel with them. When Clash of the Castle was coming, I tried to try my hand at trying to get some media stuff, you know, and right. I'm like how needy do I sound? Like, do I send one email, but then if they haven't replied, do I send another email? But then how much of a needy bitch am I looking at if I send a third email? It's just
exactly. And, oh. And they would turn around and say, oh, well, you know, that's showing you got gums. Kids got moxie. I found that out only recently. Jamie Kennedy told me that that apparently my name was in the frame, but they never asked. No one from What Culture ever got in touch, and I'd have been up for it. I'd have been up for it.
But you've dabbled elsewhere. You appeared at Pro 2 as well. You are Pro 2.
Pro 2, yes. Well, that's down in Ayrshire. That's in my neck of the woods. I'd have been a bit of a prick not to have helped out a brand new organisation, starting where I'm from. I haven't made any regular appearances. I've literally only appeared once, I'm aware of. But I am still the commissioner of the Why So Serious division.
Yes, Joker's division. Yeah,
Joker's division. Thank you. Fuck that. I've always been, you know, in wrestling, I've always been open to offers. The only thing I think I've ever said is, if someone were to get in touch from wrestling, like, you need to do it. Like, don't do it the week before, because chances are I've already got something on. Don't get me wrong, if something nice and juicy came in, I'd be like, fuck yes, I'll drop those gigs and Fife on their head and I'll come and do your thing. But I've always been an open book when it comes to working with other organizations, and thankfully I'd like to think I've got a diverse enough kind of skill set, because people might turn in and go, oh, you know, it does ICW, he swears and he jokes around. It's like, yeah, but I also do, like, I've also done, like, morning radio. I'm also on, like, BBC Radio Scotland. I'm also doing kids shows and other forms of presenting and all that. I reckon I could probably turn my hand to most things. Am I a good ring announcer? No idea. It's never really interested me much. But in terms of commentary or being a talking head, although I'd love to be a heel manager. You know what? I'd love to be heel colour. I'd fucking love to be heel colour, man. I'd get folk. Fucking folk would hate me, man. That'd be amazing. I'd love that.
Is that something you're going to try and work with Ryan Fitzsimmons, who your new partner in crime on commentary? You maybe just see if he'll just kind of just be a bit more baby, and you can Halloween, next Glasgow Bash.
I'd probably suggest an ICW. I've never been exactly a baby face, because I've listened back to some of the things I've said, and it's like, man, that doesn't make me sound like a good guy at all. I don't know. Maybe Billy fucking Kirkwood is a little bit. I think Billy fucking Kirkwood's a tweener, to be honest.
Mm.
I think Billy fucking Kirkwood is a tweener. Billy Kirkwood's probably a face. Although I don't know. I don't know, that's an interesting one. But no, I've enjoyed working with Ryan. It's something different from Jamie. Ryan comes from more, I mean, he's a lifelong wrestling fan. He's a wonderful guy. But he comes from more of a football broadcasting background. So it's kind of getting that merge. But we're working together and we're enjoying ourselves. We're enjoying ourselves. And I've enjoyed working with him. He's a nice guy. He's really fun. And we've become friends. So that's always nice. You kind of have to when you've got a regular wrestling partner, you know, you have to get on. Like, we did audition when Jamie left. We auditioned, which is what it's quite common in, like, radio shows and stuff and other things, when you know it's going to be two of you going back and forth. You audition. I auditioned with we auditioned a couple of people, but me and Ryan was, I did actually, once Ryan had left, I went, that's the guy. Not that it was my decision, but I mean, obviously the guys at ICW took my input. I did say that that's the guy. So I've enjoyed working with Ryan. Bless him. Tons of him in a suit. Shot him in the balls of the Super Soaker on Sunday. So again,
yeah,
I don't think Billy fucking Kirkwood has a face.
But it's been all changed, of course, because Jen left. We've got Kat now as well, and it's just that it's a bit of a changing vibe and experience in ICW, certainly in the last 18 months or so, last 2 years. So, but before we go back into the wrestling chat, we've got to plug Wild Thing, because that's what we're here for. So before I do that, I'll read the first paragraph of the press release that is on our website. Renowned comedian, presenter, devoted father, and loving husband, Billy Kirkwood is set to make a triumphant return to the stage with his high-energy, wildly entertaining show, Wild Thing. After a recent surgery almost put the brakes on his vibrant career, Billy is back, more determined than ever to spread his unique brand of frantic positivity and relentless fun.
Oh, so, nice.
That's good. Beehive Inn, Grass Market, August 2nd to 26th. Pay what you can.
Yes.
We'll have a QR code on the thumbnail of this video as well.
So oh, what?
Go do that. I've just literally cut it out of your poster to put it on.
Oh, cheers, mate. Thank you. Thank you.
So yeah, Wild Thing. You had your surgery. Is this now kind of just, if people thought you were kind of off the rails before, is this kind of the wheels are off and you're just let loose?
You know, the phrase that I'd use is gratitude, is kind of what is oozing out of the show. And there's also a kind of element of fuck it, if not now, when? I think sometimes it's easy to get bogged down. Like, even as a comedian, like, so the finale of Wild Thing, if you can call it that, is something that when I did it a couple of weeks ago in a preview, I started smiling and laughing in the middle of it. And my mate, who was my support act in the night, went, What was going on there? And I went, I was just laughing. All I saw was all these other comedians' faces and how much they would fucking hate that I'm doing this. But and it just made me so happy that I just didn't give a shit. I just did not give a shit. Like, it's kind of what we were talking about wrestling. Man, it's a show that's just bursting with, it's funny, it's filthy, it's high energy. There's no sad bits. There's no narrative. We might talk a little bit about the subject, but again, only if it's funny and if it's only fitting in the vibe. The show's a wee bit different every day. It's basically, come and see a show at the Fringe that is just pure enjoyment. That's what I want to go for. Because the surgery thing, without dwelling on it too far, basically I ended up having a lump, which I've shown I don't know if I've shown this already, I'm not sure, as I have a scar running now, this big would see it kind of from behind my ear right down to the base of my throat. I think when they actually measured it, it is like 6-7 inches in length down the side of my neck. But that was a guy that measured it, so it was probably only 3 inches. That gag's in the show. So if you want to hear that gag again, that gag's in the show. So basically what happened was, and this is the complete truth, is my wife noticed a slight bump behind my neck December of last year. And because I'm a guy and I'm busy and I'm self-employed, I just went, it's not causing me any pain. Let's not think about it anymore. And then it got a little bigger. And then I started not feeling particularly well, but I still kept going. So people turn around and go, oh, what happened? Did you not feel well? And then you went and saw a doctor. Nope, I stopped feeling well in December, but kept going. I'll get through the Glasgow Comedy Festival, I'll get through such and such, blah, blah, blah. I flew to New York to do Tartan Week. And while I was when I came back in 24 hours, I was in New York, 24 hours, fucking sickening, right? I never ever want to do that again. New York's amazing, but you don't want to be there for just 24 fucking hours, do you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. 24 hours is what you go to Glasgow for, you know, it's like on a day. Anyway, but I came back and my neck had swollen up quite significantly, And I knew that this was trouble because it was really, really sore and really, really caused me all my problems. So I went and I got taken in. That on its own is quite terrifying, Billy. When you go from like somebody going like, oh, you know, we'll maybe just give you antibiotics, going, no, we're taking you in. And it's like, what? And suddenly I realized that I might be in trouble. So that's when I'll come and say the word cancer started getting kicked around, which no one ever wants to hear in their life. Now, here's the thing I will say to anyone. Do remember, like, cancers when caught early are treatable. And there's lots of different types of cancers, like from cancer, you know, people get moles and what have you that are cancerous, cut off, and, you know, all these types of things. So I was told early on that if this were cancer, because of where it is, I should be okay. I might need to get radiotherapy, and radiotherapy is not a nice thing to hear either, but it could have put the brakes on everything. So what they do is they send you home after nothing. Like, so they send you home. And then you come back and you get, once the swelling goes down, I got a test that came back. Then this was the initial, is this cancer test, right? And it came back and the result was inconclusive.
Oh.
So it's like, shit.
Yes.
So it's, you're kind of hoping it comes back. Oh, it's definitely not. So it went from, we need to get this out of you now. Because the one thing is, So the good news is about this. So they took it out. They dealt with me quite because I got my big old rugby playing neck. As you can see, they've had to cut me open quite the thing. Oh, people are fucking experts, man. Oh, it'll just be a wee pinhole thing. Oh, it'll just be the wee such and such. It's like, what is it, balls? It's a big scar down right down my neck. So either way, and then it gets sent away for a biopsy. So you've got to wait another 3 weeks before you find out again if it's cancer. And this is when they were saying, if this is, you're going to have to go for radiotherapy, and that's probably going to take about, between radiotherapy and recovery and the surgery, you're going to be out for like 6 months at least. So the problem is, though, you're self-employed. So I took 10 days off before I had to start gigging again, not knowing whether I had cancer or not. But the good news is that on the day I was due to go back gigging, I got a call from a doctor telling me I had the all clear. So the whole aspect of it is that there was a 2 month period there where life was the most horribly unpleasant place to be. Cause I'm a dad of three. I don't know how I'm going to pay my bills. I don't know how X, Y, and Z is going to work. I'm also very sick and being run down. I mean, this cyst that they're saying, this could have been fucking me up for a couple of years. So I ended up being a badly infected cyst. They don't know why it got infected, but our bodies full of, just to educate everyone for a tiny little second, we've got all these cysts throughout our body. We have all the time, which shouldn't suddenly then try and fucking poison you and kill you. But this one did. So this one was kind of fucking up my system. It actually explains so much. Because even though I'm a naturally quite energetic guy, I was having lots of trouble sleeping and felt kind of sluggish. So it sort of came out with that. So to suddenly get, and even the Fringe, like I had booked in a Fringe show, which may or may not happen. Like at the start of, until like the second week of June, it was still kind of like, this might not happen. And then it's like people are saying, oh, what about gigs in October? What about gigs in September? And you're like, I don't know. You know, where are we going to go and have dinner? We're going to do anything at Halloween? We're going to do anything at Christmas? I don't know. So it's about kind of recovering from what was quite a negative place. And the thing is, like, God, it's putting into the mindset of someone with ADHD and as a comedian, man, it's like, fuck, you will go to the most negative place so fucking fast. But thankfully, and I have to say, I was surrounded by some wonderful and amazing supportive people and friends, both in wrestling and both out of wrestling and both in comedy and outside of comedy, who could not have had my back more mentally. And I am filled with nothing but gratitude. And for this, it's a case of just having the most fun and wanting to spread that story and wanting to spread that energy. And that's what Wild Thing is. That's what Wild Thing is. I did a show at the Glasgow Comedy Festival this year called House Party, which is all about positive mind space and kind of doing that. And Wild Thing's kind of an evolution of that, because we're just turning that up to fucking 100, man. And I don't care or not whether it's an audience of one or if it's a fucking sellout. It's going to be the same grandstanding show with a big stupid Celine Dion finish at the end. So that's kind of what the show's about. There's not going to be too much on the hospital. There's about 10 minutes on it, but it's all quite positive. It's also just the quite weird things. Like when a woman flashed me a wrong boob after she'd had surgery, that was not what I expected. She went, "I got a bit of my boob removed, look." And then she went, "Oh no, hang on, that was." And it was just like, "What's going on? What's going on? You just flashed me the wrong tit. What's going on?"
Tell my wife this, sir.
Yeah, this is a woman I've just met as well. Well, she knew me. And that was actually the frustrating thing. Like when I actually got my operation was down in Ayrshire and everyone fucking knew me. Everyone, and so I'm like, fuck man, I don't want to be. Well, imagine when my shorts, my dick falls out, like just fucking, you know, I don't want to hear any, just all these kind of nightmares. So there's a little bit about that. It's turning positives into negative, turning negatives into positives. Don't want to get that mixed up. That's what the show's about, man. That's what the show's about. So, and as you can see, I'm quite, I don't want to say it like turns your life around. And hey, listen, as we all get on in life, you know, you have all your struggles and all that type of shit. But yeah, this one has not kept me down. I'm glad I kept my head on during this. And I would encourage, and we're actually doing a thing with it down here in Ayrshire. It's about vocalizing for men, medical issues. Don't be that guy. Don't be your dad. Don't be your granddad. Go to the fucking doctor. Ask your friends, you know, look after yourself, because, you know, we're a generation that, you know, we shouldn't be fucking dying. You got high blood pressure, go and see your fucking doctor. If you got a bump where you shouldn't have one, go and see your fucking doctor. Nobody's going to suddenly go like, oh, you know, Davey died at 40, but what a fucking trooper he was. You never heard him complain. No one's ever fucking said that in their life. I had a friend that was incredibly healthy and a power lifter who passed away at 40. About a month ago. So he was 4 years my junior, and basically the issues that he had with his heart that he knew about, if he'd had done something about those, he'd be with us today. So there's a lot of positive stuff come from it, man. A lot of positive stuff come from it. With me not dying, that's quite good, because I won't lie. See, the idea of going for surgery, fucking terrifying. And I started with surgery in the bit of your head where loads of really fucking important things are. Do you know what I mean? Like you're meant to get like hand surgery or like foot surgery or some shit. You know, I went with fucking lots of vital organs and all the, yeah, that kind of catches you a bit off guard to go there. We have to knock you out. And that's no fun, man. Cause I was like every other guy in the world. It's like, you think you're getting put out and you might not wake up, which was just ridiculous. And I have to say, like, all the doctors and stuff that looked after me, Lorna, my doctor, Dr. Lorna Langstaff, who is now a close personal friend, could not have been more amazing. Could not have been more amazing. So yeah, lots of love for the NHS. And I think I even said that when we were going into a recent election. It's like, I don't really care how you vote, but protect the NHS at all costs, which kind of also indicated how I think people should have voted. Yeah. So there we go.
I mean, I haven't had anything as serious as that, but I remember when I broke my arm. They have to go through all the things that could happen, because just for their own liability's sake. It's like there's a 2% chance if something goes wrong, you may lose your arm. So there I was, lying down, with getting the stuff, having to count back from 10, getting to 7, and then waking up, only thinking, oh, well, I'll have 2% chance. That's what's going to happen. I'm going to wake up with no arm. That's it. Yeah. I'm just going to wake up without an arm. And I woke up, and it was fine. It was in the cast and all that kind of stuff. And I was like, Jesus, that was my whole worry was going, was waking up without an arm. Thankfully, it's my left. It's useless, but you know, still would have been there.
But I totally get that when you get told the worst case scenario, and I guess in my case, because they didn't know. I mean, they mentioned, well, Rod Gilbert went through, my situation was very similar to a famous Welsh comedian called Rod Gilbert's. Rod was a lot more worse than mine. Clearly, because he actually had a very rare form of cancer. in his neck, and has thankfully now made a complete recovery. But one of the cool things about that was I've supported Rod on tour, and a couple of people said reach out to him. But the thing is, you see how Rod is thriving now, so I kept that in my head, going, well, you know, Rod's thriving, so if he can thrive, I can thrive, and it got me through everything, including the when you get put under. Because it's weird the way you kind of accept. It's just that moment of accepting, mm-hmm. when you kind of go, well, here we go, this is it. Like, as I'm not going to turn around now. I keep asking you what you're in for. Did you get that? Keep asking. Yeah. What do you think you're getting done today? It's like, am I getting this answer wrong? You know, my dad keeps saying, I'm getting a cyst cut on my neck, and you're like, no, you're getting a new pair of tits. Did you not realize that? You know, is that what they think is happening? So keep asking the question, but no, they could not be more amazing. I'd be more scared about getting my arm done, to be honest, because I wake up and they just fucking jammed a fork in with my wrist would be or some shit.
Oh, I mean, they only did one wee arrow on my hand. If I got hold of a permanent marker and I made that thing bigger, I was like, you're definitely going to take off the wrong one. This is the, if it's going to come off, it's going to be the one that's actually broken. I'm not going to wake up with one broken and one missing.
It's reassuring and not reassuring when they draw the arrow on you. And you go like, you just don't know where these are going. It's, you know, people are under pressure. It's like, fuck. And I think I was meant to be in for an hour and I was in for 2 hours. That much they told me, because he said where it was a pain in the arse to get to. That's an official quote. It's an official quote. It was a pain in the arse to get to. But no, I'm here and I'm alive, and that's what Wild Thing is all about, going through wild experiences that should break you, but they don't. They don't. That's all point.
So if anyone's forgotten at this point, it's the Beehive Inn, Grass Market, 2nd of August to 26th, 2:45 PM daily. Pay what you can. There'll be a secure code. Go to any of Billy's social media as well.
And if anyone doesn't know what pay what you can is, I believe that you should be able to come and see comedy at the festival for whatever your budget can allow. So pay what you can is so you can reserve a seat at whatever budget you're able to pay. You can come along and see the show for free and maybe put some money in the bucket or make a donation on your way out if you would like, but it's purely just to reserve a seat. So if 70 people turn up, if 70 people pre-book, you kind of get into that show. But if 50 people turn up the next day and they've reserved seats, well, there's 20 seats free, come on in and get a sit down. So I would say try and reserve your seat in advance. It helps me, it helps the guys that run the venue. I think it's a fucking great way of doing it. So these tickets on there to reserve your seat from a fiver right up to £9. You pay what you feel you can. That's what it is. You pay what you can.
Fantastic. So before we wrap up then, I want to talk a little bit more about wrestling, and then we'll go and get on with the rest of our day. We're finding right now, especially since the pandemic, that wrestlers are using social media to get their characters across even more.
Yeah.
And it's brilliant. Because I've been able to see guys like Casino Brutal and the guys that did, like Taylor Veit, one of the accountants.
Three of my favorites. Taylor Veit, I love, and the fucking accountants, man. Like, their entrance music was the hold music for HMRC. How fucking cool is that? Like, that was one of the big problems with the Great Glasgow Bash, how much I marked it through the whole thing.
But for that kind of aspect of it, is anyone coming to you to get a little bit of advice? Does anyone approach you anyway to get advice on maybe how to market themselves and how to get their character across more? Because it's an important tool, especially nowadays, because money's very precious. So you pay what you can. So people are going to pay £100 to get down from where I am to Glasgow to go see a show. So I need to know that these characters are worth that money. Are you finding that people are approaching you to maybe get a little bit of tips to kind of market themselves a little bit more as a character?
Well, I've always been a bit of an open door. If anyone ever wants to talk and stuff like that, I've always been, over the years in ICW, like sometimes I've chucked in things on commentary which I thought would help the characters, and then someone's went, hey, that's great, can I use that? Or they've just went and used that, and hey, they have my blood. If I say it into a microphone over their match, it's theirs as far as I'm concerned. Do you know what I mean? If they like it, it's theirs. It's like, I always remember there was the Carmel Jacob thing. Like, I called her the Pipe Bomb Princess for about like 6 months and was literally about to stop calling her it. And then she came out at like the Battlelands with Pipe Bomb Princess written across the back of her tights. And I was like, you like it? And she's like, I fucking love it. And it's like, oh, you know, so really nice. And again, I know sometimes some wrestlers have sought me out to just have a creative chat, which I'm more than happy to do. Sometimes it's just nice to spitball. I mean, I've done classes and stuff like that on improv and unlocking creative thinking. So I tend to try and do it via that. In fact, the guys down at GPWA in Glasgow have had brought a whole bunch of different people in for different classes to do that. But that is one of the big things I kind of proponent in that, is in terms of like trying everything and unlocking what you can do to get your characters over. I'm by no means saying I'm an expert or anything, like in terms of what you can do, but I can help you get there. I'm good at that. I'm good at facilitator and helping generate ideas. And the advice that I always give is try it. Don't let the voice in your, like, I mean, it is that big thing, like, better to try it and fail. I mean, you have permission to fail, so why not take the chance? Do you know what I mean? Like, I mean, look at Seth Rollins. Look at where Seth Rollins was. Look at where he is now. Imagine he just stayed as Tyler Black. Mm-hmm. Like, imagine he never changed that. Well, this is working in ROH. I'll just keep doing that. He would have never made it to where he is right now. One of the icons of the industry. I mean, he's got a Hall of Fame career, and you know, he's probably still got at least a decade to go. But when people do, I'm more than willing to listen. But I also think I will go out my way to give people kudos when I think it's a great thing that they're doing. Do you know what I mean? Like, Taylor's a prime example. I think Taylor's a great talker and does everything he does. The Casino Brutale, they took something that they liked and made it part of who they were and really expanded it as a brand. Those are the guys that will stand out, the guys and the girls that do that. I mean, look at Rio. Rio, over the last 2 years, I think has really grown into that persona. I mean, like, Rio just screams superstar when she walks onto a screen or into a venue now, in my opinion. Yeah, people do, and that's lovely, and I'm more than happy to do that, whether it be in a class or whether it be in a voicemail, or hey, if someone wants me up and have a coffee, more than happy to do that. But yeah, talk to your I would say this to anyone out there in terms of like comedy or wrestling or anything like that. Talk to your mates, generate ideas, talk to your partner, but also feel free to actually reach out to someone else in your industry, someone that you idolize or someone that you think would mentor or give you feedback in that, good or bad, because you've got permission to fail. So fail and learn. Like, better to fall forward than fall back, as they say. Or is it better to step forward than fall back? Is that the phrase? I can never remember. But yeah, that's it. So when people do, I'm more than happy. If that were my full-time job, it's probably the only thing that could steal me away from comedy. Would be just helping people with unlocking their own creativeness. That would be something that I'd love.
Fantastic. Right, so before we go, there's always been heavy rumor of you doing your own wrestling podcast, and I think this is kind of maybe scratching that itch for the moment that we've got to speak about wrestling on a podcast.
Yes.
But yeah, hopefully one day we get the Billy Kirkwood experience on wrestling, because I think there's a gap where wrestling daft ended that's just waiting to be filled. And I mean, I would love to get the numbers they were getting, but there's that gap there already for
you.
Allegedly again.
I've only said that because if any of them saw this, I would fucking love for them to be in the lineup. I know, like, all the way from producer John, who was a mate of mine at Radio Clyde, John McNally. Of course, I think Rab is fantastic, and everyone knows I love Grado the Bits. We called him by his government name. How dare I? There have been two aborted wrestling podcast. One that came so close to getting promo, fucking hell. One, we got promos done. We got a website built. Everyone was, yeah, I'm up for doing this. And then when we went, right, we need to start recording it. Well, I'm only free for like 20 minutes on a fucking Saturday afternoon. And that's how quick it fell apart. And then there's another one which I was due to do, but obviously the surgery put tail to that. So what I can say is I hope to be launching a new wrestling podcast by the end of the year. And it will not... Well, we might have a little talk about current wrestling and everything's going on. The idea is that... well, let me put it to you this way. You're going to build your own wrestling company from the ground up. That's what we're doing. So imagine... There it is. We are starting a wrestling company from day one, from talking about the roster to pay-per-views? Where's going to be our home venue? What color the fucking ring ropes are going to be? What the t-shirts are going to look like? Like, literally every episode is going to be about building this wrestling company that does not exist. Or maybe it will one day. What is the name of the company going to be? Who the fuck knows? What's our... Look, so we're going to have... It's basically talking about all the things you love about wrestling. So we're playing kind of halfway between fantasy wrestling and halfway between real world wrestling. And the idea is if you were going to call it the Kirkwood Wrestling Federation, I guess you could call it that. But so I feel like I'm Triple H and Nick Tan. I'm not the other guy who we don't talk about anymore until the FBI cleared him. That's kind of what we're doing, and we're having a lot of fun in that world, and the enthusiasm people had for it was really, really cool. So it's kind of swimming in the waters of the Great Glasgow Bash, if you like, but in podcast form. And the whole thing is going to be kind of creating discussion with fans and what they're into and what we think is good ideas and all that. So that's what I'm actually the most excited about, is somebody going like, what about purple and green ring ropes? And us going, yeah, it's, or going, oh my God, that'd be amazing for a Halloween show, do you know? So, and then we're going to be putting it together. I'm really looking forward to it, but I'm all in or I'm all out, and at the moment, it's going to have to wait until after the Fringe, I'm afraid.
So there's the future. That's fine. Doesn't like sound like stepping in my territory. Then I'm going to have to go. I'm going to have to spread some rumors.
Are you and the rest of the other wrestling podcast going to pay someone to break my legs? Is that what was going to happen?
I'm going to use my Patreon money somehow.
love it.
Anyway, thank you very much for taking time to speak to me. This has been we could probably speak here another hour very easily about all manner of wrestling topics, but we'll leave it there for a moment. We'll tickle the I'll basically tickle the balls. I feel like I don't know why I've went.
It's not tickle the balls. I mean, nothing that's frowned upon.
It's Zoom anyway. It's fine. It'd just be my own. I'm tickling. But thank you very much for speaking to me. Where can people find out more if you want to plug all your stuff? We've plugged the Wild Thing show at the Beehive Inn, which everyone should hopefully know by now, because I've plugged it that many times during this.
Thank you, sir. Episode. I do appreciate that.
But anything else you want to plug, go for it.
At the moment, I would probably say, listen, just find me on social media. I am doing my fucking best. No cunt knows who I am. So I'm doing my best to try and change that a little bit. So if you want to get in touch, whether you can either Google me, Billy Kirkwood Comedian, unbelievably, I still come up first. You can find me on, I'm spending more time on Instagram. So you can find me on Instagram, you can find me on Facebook, find me on X, but no one else is there. It's like being at a party at a fucking pervert's house. Nobody's hanging about there anymore. So, but you can find me there, and my link tree's there with kind of everything that's currently going on at that exact time. So right now, yes, it's all popping at the Fringe, but some cool stuff coming up. So looking forward to getting in about that.
Perfect. Well, thank you very much. We'll be right back.